We have been given the scientific knowledge, the technical ability, and the materials to pursue the exploration of the universe. To ignore these great resources would be a corruption of a God-given ability.
It's estimated that about 650 million people watched the first moon landing in 1969, nearly a quarter of the world's population. As the world watched those powerful Saturn V rocket engines burst into life, they witnessed plumes of sooty exhaust billow from the five shuddering nozzles as it pushed itself off the ground, burning through a colossal volume of kerosene to lift the rocket's massive 3 million kilogram weight off the ground. Soon, the first stage shut off and separated, allowing the second stage to roar into life, this time powered by a different fuel, liquid hydrogen. A fuel capable of providing better performance, but it occupied too much space. Liquid hydrogen is considerably less dense than kerosene, so needs to be combined in a much higher ratio with liquid oxygen. For every liter of oxygen burned in the Saturn V first stage, it required 0.64 liters of kerosene, while its second stage needed 3.25 liters of hydrogen for every liter of oxygen. NASA engineers couldn't feasibly make the Saturn V first stage fuel tanks any larger, so liquid hydrogen was not an option. The science of rocket fuel is a fascinating and complicated field, combining not just physics, chemistry, and engineering, but also logistics. That's the challenge facing SpaceX as it develops the next generation of heavy lift rockets, designed to take us not just to the moon, but further to Mars. Starship's Raptor engines will not use kerosene or liquid hydrogen. They will use methane, a fuel that was considered frequently over the past century of rocket fuel research, with a few honorable mentions in John D. Clarke's seminal book, Ignition. But it has never seen widespread use. So, why is SpaceX using it now? Putting people on the moon in the 1960s was one of the greatest technological challenges we'd ever faced. But getting humans to Mars is a considerably more difficult task, especially when you factor in the enormous challenge of keeping humans there, of creating and sustaining a human settlement on the red planet. How do you reduce the cost of launches? How do you make the oxygen needed to stay alive? How do you provide water for growing food and for drinking? And how do you make the fuel to power the return trip to Earth? Kerosene and hydrogen are not perfect. Kerosene is extracted from crude oil via fractional distillation and is made up of a mixture of long-chain hydrocarbons, reaching up to around 20 carbons in length. The longer the hydrocarbon, the harder it is to burn completely in oxygen, as they require more oxygen per gram of fuel to be completely oxidized into carbon dioxide and water. And so, even in its refined form, kerosene often burns incompletely, decomposing instead into smaller reactive radicals. The result is coking, the production of sooty carbon particulates that we saw in the Saturn V's launch. This soot can easily clog up the intricate mechanisms of the rocket engine, which is a problem for SpaceX and its goal to make its engines reusable with minimal maintenance, especially on Mars, where the facilities to fix these issues will not be available. Liquid hydrogen, of course, doesn't have this problem, and it has the advantage of burning more efficiently than kerosene. We can quantify this efficiency with specific impulse. Specific impulse describes how efficiently a fuel can convert its mass into thrust. To understand this, let's first look at total impulse, which describes the thrust force generated over the entire burn period of the engine. We can graph this rather easily by plotting the thrust the engine is providing for each second of its flight. That may look something like this. The total impulse is found by finding the area under this graph, which gives us the total energy the rocket released. This is a useful metric in itself, but specific impulse is better, because not all propellants are born equal. Two different fuel and oxidizer combinations could provide the same total impulse, but we need to consider the weight of the fuel and oxidizers themselves. After all, the initial weight of rockets is always dominated by the weight of their own fuel. To find the average specific impulse, we divide the total impulse by total propellant weight the rocket expelled. Going by this metric, a liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen fuel mixture is by far the best. Hydrogen has a much higher specific impulse than kerosene, around 390 seconds against kerosene's 285 seconds. However, as mentioned earlier, hydrogen is much less dense than kerosene, requiring much larger fuel tanks. Hydrogen also has an exceptionally low boiling point at minus 252 degrees Celsius, and so the tanks need to be heavily insulated to avoid expansion of the liquid hydrogen. But thermodynamic equilibrium is a war of attrition that the universe will always win, and so they also require boil-off valves to release gaseous hydrogen to prevent an explosion. This all adds mass and complexity to the rocket. Hydrogen also degrades and weakens metals in a process known as hydrogen embrittlement. This is a massive issue for SpaceX's reusability design ethos. Combining two parameters, the density and the specific heat of combustion, we can get an idea of the difference between these three fuels. If we want to release 100 megajoules of energy from each of these three fuels, we would need 11.9 liters of hydrogen, 2.2 liters of kerosene, or 5.5 liters of methane. Methane is much closer to kerosene than hydrogen, allowing methane fuel tanks to be smaller than liquid hydrogen fuel tanks, but not small enough to offer much performance benefits over kerosene. When the necessary design changes are made to switch from kerosene to liquid methane, like increasing the fuel tank volume, the increase in specific impulse is all but negated. This is why methane has never seen widespread use. Methane simply sits in an awkward middle ground between the two most popular fuels. It provides better performance than kerosene, but not as good as hydrogen. And it's easier to store than hydrogen, but not as easy as kerosene. Its benefits are only now becoming useful as SpaceX works to unlock the magic of reusable rockets. Methane is a single carbon hydrocarbon, so unlike the long chain molecules found in kerosene, it produces significantly less soot when burnt, leading to less damage to the engine over time. Its boiling point is actually higher than liquid oxygen's, allowing much of the necessary infrastructure to liquefy and use oxygen to be used for liquid methane. Very important when working with limited infrastructure on Mars. But most importantly, the real reason methane has suddenly become very attractive to SpaceX is that it can be synthesized from the carbon dioxide-rich atmosphere of Mars. Mars's atmosphere is almost entirely carbon dioxide. 95% of the Martian atmosphere is CO2, with the remaining 5% being made up from gases like nitrogen, argon, and a trace amount of oxygen. While this carbon dioxide-rich atmosphere may be a disadvantage when it comes to establishing a city on Mars, it provides huge advantages when it comes to creating rocket fuel. We have come to see carbon dioxide as a waste gas, something produced as a byproduct of combustion, instead of as a raw material. But it has an enormous potential to act as a feedstock for the production of methane. Over 100 years ago, a chemist called Paul Sabatier came up with a process of converting carbon dioxide into methane by passing it through a catalyst, usually nickel, with hydrogen gas at an elevated temperature and pressure. The reaction takes 1 mole of carbon dioxide and reacts with 4 moles of hydrogen to produce 1 mole of methane and 2 of water. When combined with our electrolysis process, this produces 1 mole of methane to 2 moles of oxygen. The ratio of moles, the stoichiometry, is going to be important soon. But the first question is, how do you get your chemical reagents on Mars? Well, for this, we need in-situ resource utilization. Getting carbon dioxide is a relatively easy task. With an atmosphere made up of 95% carbon dioxide, extracting a pure sample of the compound is straightforward enough. But we do need to get rid of that other 5% and condense the carbon dioxide. Currently, cryo-freezing is the most viable option. Carbon dioxide has the highest freezing point of the gases present in Mars's atmosphere, So, in a process that is essentially the opposite of distillation, we can cool the air to separate the carbon dioxide, which will freeze into a solid while the other gases remain as a gas. This also naturally compresses the carbon dioxide. Then, when we need to use it in our Sabatier reactor, it can be simply warmed up to create a high-pressure stream of gaseous CO2. However, getting the necessary hydrogen is much more difficult. The first option is to import it directly from Earth, but given how much is required and the difficulty storing it for long periods, this isn't a great option. So, long term, we will want to extract it from the resources available on Mars. Water is contained within Martian soil, but most significantly, it's found in the form of ice in the polar regions of the planet. If we can find a way of mining the water, we can then convert it into oxygen and hydrogen using an electric current, and then the hydrogen can be combined with carbon dioxide to produce methane. Remember when we said that the molar ratios would be important? Here's why. That 2-to-1 molar ratio of oxygen to methane gives us a mass ratio of 4-to-1 of oxygen to methane. The propellant mixture employed by SpaceX's Raptor engine uses a 3.4-to-1 ratio, so this whole process gives us an excess of oxygen, which can be put towards the life support systems in our Martian city. A win-win. But extracting large quantities of water from Mars, either from ice in the polar regions or from the small quantities of liquid water in the soil, would not be easy, and the technology to do this on a large scale doesn't exist yet. Over the short term, if we brought our own hydrogen to Mars, we end up with a 1-to-1 mole ratio of oxygen and methane, which isn't enough to burn our methane completely. So, if we're going this route, we need a way to produce additional oxygen. The best way is to use another process which would benefit from Mars's carbon dioxide-rich atmosphere, the reverse water gas shift reaction. This looks very similar to the Sabatier process, and involves the reaction of carbon dioxide with hydrogen, but instead of producing methane and water, it produces carbon monoxide and water. The water that's formed in this reaction can then be electrolyzed, and the hydrogen can be recycled back into the reactor. Again, when the equations of the processes are combined, it gives us the 2-to-1 molar ratio between oxygen and methane that's needed for the propellant mixture. This gives us options if mining water on Mars proves difficult. But the additional advantage of this approach is that these two reactions, the Sabatier and reverse water gas shift, can be done in the same reactor, as demonstrated by Pioneer Astronautics in 2005. This combination of these two reactions has an enormous thermal advantage. Because the Sabatier reaction is exothermic, it releases heat, and the reverse water gas shift reaction is endothermic, it absorbs heat. This leads to an overall reduction of 35% in heat generation, improving the efficiency of the whole process. But despite how long the Sabatier reaction has been around, the research into optimizing the process is only a couple of decades old. For most of its life, the Sabatier reaction has been used to remove carbon dioxide from hydrogen in the production of ammonia, as it damages the catalysts used in the process of making ammonia. But in the last 20 years, scientists have begun to realize its potential in helping mitigate the effects of climate change. Instead of letting the carbon dioxide formed from burning fossil fuels into the atmosphere, what if we could collect it and turn it back into fuel using the Sabatier process? This would require a method of not only efficiently capturing carbon dioxide from the air, but a method of creating hydrogen too. These processes are currently expensive, but work is being done to reduce the cost in both energy and money. This could create a realistic economy for carbon capture to help mitigate climate change, but we are a long way off from it being cheap enough. If the technology advances, it could offer a method of storing renewable energy over extremely long periods of time as methane. There are already a handful of power-to-gas plants and projects in operation, like the Audi e-gas plant in Germany, but it has not yet reached wide-scale use. In December of last year, Elon Musk tweeted that SpaceX is funding programs into carbon capture and storage, adding that the research would be important for SpaceX's Mars missions. It's not yet clear exactly what they are developing, But it will likely be very similar to the power-to-gas projects already in development, based on the century-old Sabatier reaction. People often criticized NASA and other space initiatives as a waste of time. Why work on scientific research to help us live in space or on other planets when we have so many issues that need research here on Earth? But it's clear for anyone paying attention, working on difficult problems to make Mars habitable will directly lead to helping solve the greatest problem facing Earth today. This problem needs all hands on deck. We need as many talented engineers and scientists working on climate change as possible. That's part of the mission of this channel, to inspire the next generation of engineers, which is why I work with Brilliant. Where I can inspire, Brilliant can educate. Brilliant has created the perfect learning platform for science and mathematics, focusing on interactivity that helps you truly understand complicated subjects and continually test your knowledge as you go along. If you are stuck on a particular question, Brilliant does not punish you and impede your progress. Instead, they give you an in-depth explanation to guide you on your learning path, encouraging you to learn from your mistakes rather than building a barrier to further learning. You can start your learning journey on any number of courses, from neural networks and algorithms to logic and probability. You can learn at your own pace, learn on the go with their mobile app, and, most importantly of all, enjoy the process. You can try Brilliant for free with the link in the comments and description, or clicking the button on screen right now. And the first 200 people to sign up will get 20% off Brilliant Premium. If you're looking for something else to watch right now, you could watch our last video on the insane engineering of the Javelin missile, or you could watch Real Science's recent video on the insane biology of the Harpy Eagle.